us. Stand, grab our hymnals, turn to page number 390. As we're standing, we'll sing all three verses of Love Lifted Me, page number 390. On the first,
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
On the second,
all my heart to him I give, ever to him I cling, in his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best song, faithful, loving service to him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me.
This morning, good to see each of you here today on a bright, sunshiny morning out there. Amen. And it's supposed to be a beautiful day today and a gorgeous morning this morning. We're glad you're here. Had a good Sunday school hour. Looking forward to a good church hour. And we're so glad that you chose to be with us this morning. Let's pray and ask God to help us in our service. Our Father, we are thankful for your love that lifted us up out of the miry pit of sin. And you cleaned us up. You set us on the rock of the Lord Jesus Christ. You established our goings. Thank you for what you do for us. I pray you'll bless in our service this morning. Would you speak to our hearts? I pray that you would help each of us to draw closer to you today because of the service. I pray you'll be with the choir when they sing here in just a moment, and the congregationals, the specials. And Father, but we also ask that you be with the preaching this morning as well. We might be attentive to your word, and you might speak to us and change us. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. Our ushers are down with our guest registration packets. If you're here for the first time, hold up your hands. First timers, please raise your hand. All right here on your left and then over here. Thank you. And go ahead. And we have a little packet there we'd like for you to fill out. It's a little booklet that kind of describes our ministries. And then there's a little card we ask you to just fill out for us. We promise to safeguard that information. We don't give our list to anybody. But we would like to pray for you and have a record of your visit. And we're so glad that you're here with us today. Well, let's listen now to our choir as they sing.
In the Holy of Holies,
Behind the heavy veil sat the Ark of the Covenant, where the Most High dwell. And only the High Priest could enter therein to offer up a sacrifice for atonement of sin. But the veil was rent in an instant, revealing that holy place. For on a hill nearby, on a rugged cross, justice met grace. Just a common man, because of God's redemption plan, I can boldly approach the throne. The blood of sacrifices is no more required, for the blood of Christ, the spotless Lamb, completely paid the price. And now the sacrifice of worship will open heaven's door, allowing us to enter in the presence of the Number 361, the Lily of the Valley. I'm looking at the wrong side of the sheet. That's why. No, I'm not. 378. Again. Pick a number. I had my sheet turned over. Sorry about that. It's one confused. 378. Now I belong to Jesus.
It's the lack of oxygen.
I didn't take my meds today. I'm sorry. Here we go.
Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever.
Eternity on the second. Once I was Jesus came down to bring me salvation, lifted me up from sorrow and shame. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me, not for the years of time alone, but for eternity on the last. Joy floods my freed me from sin that long had enslaved me, precious blood he singing this morning. Please be seated.
Enjoy that choir special, amen. Good stuff. Singing like that, though, that's, you know, a couple weeks ago, it was last Sunday, I was acting like crazy man while I was preaching. I know that shocks you. When I yanked Brother Allen out of his pew and drug him across here, I had to get back to the pulpit, almost had to use my inhaler to calm my lungs back down. So, John, I'm with you. Amen. I know where you're at, amen. And so, praise the Lord, good singing this morning. Just a couple of announcements. For those of you that like to use the Baptist Bread devotionals, little devotional books, they're in, the new ones that start in May. And so if you'd like to get one of those, you can stop by in our bookstore, and there's no cost for those. And I encourage you to use those, or, you know, just it's a good way to help you get it, especially if you're new to reading your Bible and studying. It's a good way to just kind of give you some structure. And I would recommend that you do that. And so stop by and see those after the church service.
All right, so next week, Sunday, we're going to be having dinner on the grounds. I believe we have a clipboard to pass for that. So, gentlemen, if you bring that forward and then just pass it to the first person and pass it on back. But we'd like to for everybody to join us next Sunday following the morning service. For a great time of fellowship, for dinner on the grounds. Basically what that means is bring a meal large enough for your family, plus some to share. So if you have a large family, it's going to be a lot of food. Or if you don't have a large family like us, we still like to bring a lot of food. So thing is, bring food. But sign up on the clipboard to let us know that you are planning on coming, so that way we can have tables and stuff set out and be prepared for everybody that's going to be here. So we're just going to have a good time. That is next Sunday after the morning service.
He makes me nervous. Every time he stands up to let Alan back in, I think he's coming up to make an announcement. All right, coming up on this Saturday, the 29th, we do have the ladies' conference. So if you are planning on going to that, we do need to know that. It's going to be this Saturday from 8:30 to 2. And if you have signed up, there will be a meeting, following the morning service, from the auditorium over here on the front side with Mrs. Brandenburg. So if you have signed up for that or you're still interested in going, please come up here right after the service so we can just work out a few details of what's going on for that Saturday. And I'm going to flip that over to the right service. And as we stand, let's turn to page number 829, Where We'll Never Grow Old. We'll sing the first verse and then shake hands with one another. Page number 829. On the first,
I have heard of a land on the faraway strand. 'Tis a beautiful home of the soul, built by Jesus on high. There we never shall die. 'Tis a land where
as we make our way back to our seats, we'll continue singing on verse number 2, page number 829, verse 2.
In that beautiful home, where we'll never more roam, we shall be in the sweet by and by. Happy praise to the King, through eternity. Never grow old,
singing. I like that. Amen. We'll never grow old. This week I was studying on heaven. Actually, probably the reason I was thinking about that was my aunt went to heaven on Monday night. And I had somebody during the week ask me about heaven. And so I just started looking at scriptures and things. And one of the things that you see there, there's not going to be any graveyards in heaven.
Amen.
Nobody gets old. Won't that be wonderful?
Amen.
Amen. I mean, I'm still young. I'm only 55. I see 56 coming real fast. It's not far down the road. But Brother Bill, I can't do things at 55. I did at 45. And a whole lot of things I couldn't do when I was 35, and we won't go any further back. So, amen. As our good friend Dr. Ed Nelson, the preacher that married Rhonda and I, he's in his 90s still preaching, and he says, it's getting old. It's not for sissies. And we get to heaven, we won't have to worry about that anymore. Amen. Great singing today. We're so glad that you're here. If you're a guest and you filled out that little card, please drop that in the offering plate when it comes by. That way we have a record of your visit. And on the card there was a place for prayer requests. If you have something you'd like for us to pray for, please put that on there. We'd be honored to pray for you. And let's go ahead and pray for our offering. Let's be faithful to our giving. And let's have Brother John, why don't you lead us in prayer. Man, thank you. Maybe seated.
He was wounded for our transgressions. He bore our sins in his body on the tree. For our guilt he gave us peace, from our bondage gave release. And with his stripes, and with his stripes, and with his stripes, our souls are healed.
Amen.
He was numbered among transgressors. We did esteem him forsaken by his God. As our sacrifice he died, that the law be satisfied. And all our sin, and all our sin, and all our sin was laid on him. We had wandered, we all had wandered far from the fold of the shepherd of the sheep. He sought us where we were on a mountain. shall declare all the triumphs of his cross. Millions dead outlive again, myriads follow in his train. Victorious Lord, victorious Lord, victorious Lord and coming King.
It's always good to think about our Savior, amen? Think about what price he paid, and the price that he paid was what you and I would have spent eternity paying, and he suffered for us, amen? Thank you for that singing. I appreciated the choir song, the one that they sang with John this morning. They had planned to sing last week. Let me get everything turned on here. They were planning on singing that special last Sunday, but John had his surgery on his shoulder, say that five times fast, a week ago, and last Sunday, he was not in condition to be here, still heavily medicated, and so I appreciate that, but that's okay. We're not going to reserve songs about the cross and about the resurrection. We're not going to reserve those just for Easter Sunday or Resurrection Sunday. Every Sunday's Resurrection Sunday, amen? And let's take our Bibles, turn to the book of Ephesians chapter 5, please. Ephesians chapter 5, we'll begin reading in verse number 1. Please be praying, Brother Bernie. His allergies are just going crazy right now, and how that goes when you have trouble keeping your eyes open. And I had to move the lilies that we had last Sunday down here. I'm allergic to those, just the scent and all of that. And, man, when I was preaching last Sunday, I was standing back here, and I'd be kind of okay over here, but when I would step down there, man, it hit me like a ton of bricks, and we had them this week, and I was going to announce to ladies, if you wanted to take some home, take them. I forgot to do that. I was going to do that Wednesday, and I didn't do that, and we just decided during the week, they're leaving, and so they're out front on this, next to the awning there. If you want one of the lily plants, help yourself to them, amen. I just can't be around them. They're beautiful to look at. Just, they're going to kill me. So, but anyway, pray for Brother Bernie as he's battling those allergies like many of us are. Amen. Ephesians chapter number 5. We'll begin at verse number 1 and we'll read down through verse number 16. Actually, we'll go through verse 17. Ephesians 5. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. But fornication and all uncleanness and covetousness, let it not once be named among you as becometh saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light, for whatsoever doth make manifest is light. Wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. We'll stop right there in our reading. Just keep a marker there, if you will, in Ephesians 5. We'll come right back to that. Let's pray. We'll get into the message. Our Father, pray to help us as we look at this passage that you had the Apostle Paul put on paper and sent to this local church in the city of Ephesus. And then that letter was read in the other churches. And these are instructions to them, but they apply to us as well. I pray you to help us as we study this morning. May we learn some things that will affect our behavior this week. I pray that if there is one here that does not know Jesus as Savior, may they come to know Him today. For it's in His name we pray. Amen. You know, it's a wonderful thing to have children. We have four and we have 10 grandkids. And we just love being around our kids and love being around our grandkids. Amen. We just like to do stuff as a family. And it's a blessing to watch them as they grow. And they grow way too quickly, by the way. It's amazing, you know, but we like to watch them. This morning I came in and we were getting some things ready. I was walking back across the fellowship hall, and Becky and Alan had gotten here, and Ray and Genevieve were here, and Ray's another one of those, like, Haley, you got to watch him because he's going to run to you and hug you. Well, they're just at the right height to catch you above the knees and take you down, and so you've got to be careful. And so Ray comes over to me, gives me a hug, and then little Genevieve, you know, she comes over, and of course Genevieve wasn't here last week because she was sick, and so she's wearing her Easter outfit today, and she's got the bow in her hair, and she has a bow on her dress, and she has bow on her shoes, and she was trying to show me her bow on her shoes as she's walking around holding her shoe up. It was hilarious, and then she keeps trying to see the one on her head. She was doing this. It was a riot. And then she knocked it off, and she had to have her bow back on her head. We're in trouble because she's 14 months old and already likes all the bows. And, yeah, Alan, you are in serious trouble. And she likes all the pretties, you know. But she comes over to me, and she comes, you know, she's still learning to walk. And she does okay until her brother knocks her down. But then she comes over, and she's walking along, and then she does that. She wants Pawpaw to pick her up. And you know what Pawpaw does? He picks her up. I mean, that's just what you have to do. But you know, we see those little kids, and we watch them as they learn to walk, and we notice everything about them when they're growing up. Isn't it crazy, the stuff we notice? We notice their first smile. Oh, they're smiling at me. No, that's gas. I don't smile when I have gas. I don't know who came up with that idea. It's probably the same person who said, sleep like a baby. If you've ever had a baby, you know they don't sleep. Just, you know, it's the way it works, unless you put them in the car and drive around. But we notice their first smile. We notice their first tooth, usually because they bite us with it. You know, we notice all those things when they grow up. And, of course, their first word, dada. Amen. Or pawpaw. That's a good one. That's one I keep working with them on, pawpaw. But probably that thing that we notice the most is that first step. And that really wasn't a step, but we call it that. Did you say they took a step? No, they fell forward. You know what I'm talking about? But they just get up when they're just starting to move those little feet, and they're holding on to everything. And then we're coaching them. And the funny picked film, the video, is not to film the kid. It's filming the parents saying, come to daddy. It's just hilarious to watch. You get grown people that are reasonably intelligent. Get them in a room with a baby, and they start talking goofy. Can I get a witness? It happens. But we notice when they take that first step, we'll write it down. They took their first step at such as, I don't know how old I was when I took my first step. I was kind of young. You know, I don't remember. But my mom probably would know, and dad probably wouldn't care, but mom would know. That first, they start to walk, and then what happens when they start walking, they fall down. Praise God for diapers. Cushions them, amen. And that, you know, they as you see them walking, they're wobbling, and they fall down, and you pick them back up, so let's try it again. And we encourage them. Isn't it amazing how that works? And then before long, they're walking all around the living room. And then once they get to that point where they can just walk, life as you knew it is over. Because you have to batten everything down. You have to put gates up so they can't get out. Amen. Once they're mobile, it's dangerous. But I've thought about this, Brother Mark, how much care we put into helping our children start to walk. And when they fall down, help them back up. But how much time do we give to helping our children and each other walk spiritually? And when we stumble, help each other back up. In this chapter here in the book of Ephesians chapter 5, it deals a lot with walking. And this morning I want to speak on the thought of, how's your walk? I'm not talking about whether or not you got a sore on your foot and you can't walk right, or and your knee is messed up. No, I'm talking about spiritually, how's your walk? How's it going with you? Look at verse number 2, where the Bible commands us here, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Notice it's talking about the walking here. He says, walk in love. If you're taking notes, that's my first big point. Walk in love. That is sacrifice. Amen. We're commanded to walk in love. It says, notice again, it says, walk in love as Christ also hath loved us. The standard of love that we have for each other is not whether or not somebody loves us back. It's how much did God love us? How much did Jesus love us? Well, he left heaven for us. He, as God, took the form of flesh. He became a man. Why? For us, because he loved us. He came and took upon him that flesh and lived a perfect life, and then was crucified and died and was buried, and he rose again. Why? Because he loved us. You see, the love of Christ, his walk, it is a sacrificial love that Jesus had. His love was sacrificial. It says, walk in love as Christ also had loved us. Notice what it says, and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. I love the choir song and one John sang earlier this morning about into the Holy of Holies. It's referring back to the Old Testament, where only the high priest could go into the presence of God. And he could only go once a year. But just think about that. What if you were only allowed to fellowship with God one day a year? Oh, you could talk about him. You could go to his house to worship, but he wouldn't fellowship with you. You wouldn't know his presence but one day a year. But when Jesus died on the cross and he shed his blood, when he cried, it is finished, God rent the veil in the temple from the top to the bottom. That was that curtain that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies, where only the high priest could go. And God ripped that in half. Why? Because it was no longer necessary, because that was just a picture of what Jesus was doing for us, how he paid for our sins. And because of his shed blood, we have access to the Father. Realize that when Jesus did all of that, he was doing that for us. I mean, we could all probably quote the verse. And in fact, quote it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. What was God's love like? It was so much that he gave his Son so we didn't have to die for our sins. Christ's love was a sacrificial love. His walk was a sacrificial walk. You realize everything Jesus did here on earth was for somebody else. He died on the cross so that we might be reconciled to God. When he healed people, it was so that they could then understand who he was and restore that relationship. You see, love is sacrifice. I've heard this description of love, and I believe it's the best and most accurate I've ever heard. You ever ask somebody, what's love? And they try to describe it. But this is the definition that I heard. And I think it can be backed up from Scripture. Love is seeing someone in need and wanting to see that need met and wanting to be the one that meets that need. Amen. Is that not what God did for us? He saw we were sinners that needed a Savior. As it says in Genesis 22, when Abraham was asked by Isaac, I see the fire in the wood, where is the lamb? And Abraham responded, God will provide himself a lamb. We needed a sacrifice, and God said, I'll do it. We needed a Savior. I'll be the one. And he saw our need, and he met our need. That's what love is. Love, if we're going to walk in love, then we must walk in a life that is sacrificial. Just in a word, it's living for others. Too many times in our society, we live in a very selfish society. It's all about me. It's all about me. And I've figured out that that's why people drive the way they do.
It's amazing. When I went to driver's ed training, some of you wonder if I did, but I did. And they actually taught us what merge lanes were for. You know, the whole concept is both cars keep moving, and you just kind of blend in together. You back up a little, you know, you let off your gas a little bit so the guy can get in. Is that how people drive around here? Oh, no. They see you wanting to get over on that lane. It's a exit only, and you're coming on the entrance there. And so they speed up and sit right there. Brother Mark, my flesh wants to go buy a military surplus Humvee with the 50 cal on top and blow the Toyota up that's doing that. Somebody say amen. But I can't do that because I'm a Christian. And I have to forbear. That's a tough one. Brother Howes described forbear one time as this. Said forbearance is you get to the stoplight and you're in the right-hand lane. There's a car in the left-hand lane. And you're looking across the intersection and your lane merges in with the other. It's about to end. And there's parked cars right after that. So you don't have a choice but to get over. And you're the first guy in line. And you look at the guy next to you and he looks at you. And he goes, uh-huh. And he wants to race you. And you want to see who can get up there the first and cut over. Now, I know none of you guys would ever be the guy in the right-hand lane that would just floor it. None of you would ever do that. I would. But, especially if I still had my GTO. But anyway, forbearance is knowing that, Brother Mark, and letting him go and slip in behind him. Why? Because that's just love. That's what you do to people. We're to walk in love. Jesus said, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples, that you have love one to another. The badge of a believer is not your Bible in your hand. It's how you love one another. It's about how you treat people. This week, did you demonstrate the love of God to anyone? Did you help meet their needs? Did you comfort them? Did you encourage them? Did you give them the gospel? You know, we've lost that kind of propriety in society. You notice when we have a lady that comes up to sing here a special, we men on the platform will stand up. Why? Because I was taught to do that. That's respect. When I went to Bible college, where we sat in the dining hall, if a young lady came in to the table where you were eating, you had to stand up. Now, I'm just going to tell you what us guys did. We found tables where there were no girls. Why? Because we got tired of standing for our whole meal, because there would be 10 people at the table, and they would come one at a time. And I think they were waiting at the edge. All right, the guys are sat down. Let's go walk up to them. I know they planned it. I think they taught it in the classes. But we'd stand up. Why? We're trying to respect them. When you see a lady coming across a parking lot carrying something heavy, a gentleman will go help carry that. Well, that's deferring to one another. You know what that is? That's love. That's helping people in every area that you can. That's a child helping mom and dad. Don't tell me you love your parents and you don't do anything around the house. We're talking about as a believer. Let's show people we're a child of God. Let's walk in love. It's interesting. The book of Acts says about Jesus, he went about doing good. Everywhere Jesus went, he helped people. You know, Peter and John, I love that story in Acts chapter 3. We referred to it in Sunday school this morning. In Acts chapter 3, Peter and John, they come to the temple at the time of prayer, and there's the man that was lame. He'd laid at the gate. He was begging. He couldn't work. He couldn't walk. And Peter and John came up to him and said, look on us. So he looked at them, and the Bible says he expected to receive something of them. He was wanting money. He's asking alms. He's begging. And the world is expecting something from us as believers. And Peter and John looked at him and said, silver and gold have I none. Don't you know that ruined the guy's day right there? Like, oh, that's what I want. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And the Bible says he caught him by the hand and pulled him up, and he leaping stood. I was going to do that this morning, but not today. So... But he went running around shouting and praising God. Now, he didn't get what he wanted, Brother Mark, but he got what he needed. He didn't need money. He needed to learn how to walk. God healed him. Amen? Now, what happened? Peter and John came with the answer. The answer was Jesus Christ. See, you and I as believers, if we're going to walk in love, we're going to have to be trying to find people that have a need. I'm talking about spiritual needs, and we have opportunity to help them with their physical needs and to meet those needs. I love the story, and I told this a couple weeks ago, I think, but I'm going to tell it again. The Salvation Army workers were gathered together in London for this huge conference. And they were started in the 1800s by the name of General William Booth. And he was to give the keynote address. And William Booth was an amazing preacher. But he was up in years, and it would have been the last time he would have been there. And all the workers had gathered from around the world to this big conference. They're waiting for the preacher. And he wasn't there. They finally came to the podium with a telegram. Today it would have been an email. But they had a telegram. They said, well, General Booth could not be here, but he sent his message. So everybody's on the edge of their seats. And the guy's getting ready to read it. And they're expecting him, you know, take your Bibles, turn to such and such, and go into the message. Said, here's the message. Others! And then he sat down. That was the message. Others. What? Live for others. Amen. Whatever you do, live for others. But we live in a society where everybody does it for themselves. In Mark chapter 2, you have the wonderful story. In fact, let's turn there real quickly. Mark 2. And we'll just look at this story, then we'll move on to the next thought. Mark 2. In verse number 1. And again, he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised abroad that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. So here's Jesus preaching in Capernaum. The place is packed out. Nobody could get in the room. And then you get to verse number 3. And they come unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. What does that mean? Four guys were carrying him. He was on a bed, a stretcher, if you will, just a cot. And they were carrying him, four men brought him. It says in verse number 4, and when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. We know the story how Jesus didn't just heal, just didn't forgive him of his sins, but also he says to him later, take up thy bed and rise up and walk. He healed him. But here's the interesting thing. Here was a man that needed Jesus. He needed salvation. But four men brought him to the point where he could meet with Jesus. You know what that is? That's love. That's a sacrificial love. Jesus said in John 13, 34 and 35, a new commandment I give you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love one to another. Just ask yourself this question. This week, have you demonstrated the love of God to anyone? Look back over your last week and just ask yourself, how much of my life was spent demonstrating God's love, walking in love, and how much of it was spent walking in flesh and doing what I wanted? You know, I've heard many times children say, well, my dad, you know, he doesn't love me. I said, well, how do you know that? Because he never says that. Never tells me he loves me. But yet I know the family, and I know the dad gets up every morning and goes to work real early in the morning, works in a factory all day long, and comes home and pays for the house and pays for the lights and pays for the food. When I was growing up, my dad was not real verbal about expressing his love to us, but we never doubted it. Why? Because dad worked hard to provide for us. He made sure we had what we needed. And as we've gotten older, dad's more expressive of that. Now, mom was always the one to express it. She didn't let you out of her presence until she told you she loved you. But dad just wasn't that way. That's not how his family was. And dad didn't verbalize it, Brother Mark, but he sure demonstrated it. We never doubted. Why? Because we saw what dad did to take care of us. You know, people are going to know if you love them. You can fake a lot of things, but you can't fake that. They know if you really care. The Bible says here that we're to walk in love. And it's comparing it to the love that Jesus had for us. Let's go back to Ephesians chapter 5 again. And look at verse number 8. Ephesians 5 verse 8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. So we're told, first of all, to walk in love, that sacrifice. Now he says, I want you to walk in light. To walk in light is to refrain from the darkness. I don't like walking into dark rooms. I like turning every light on in the building, in the house. That's just how I am. I like light. I don't like curtains being drawn. I like light. Amen. That's why winter is not my favorite time of year. You know, you don't have the bright sunshine. I love sunshine. I love light. You know, light is what God separated the light from the darkness. We talked about that a little while ago. How that God he said, "Let there be light," and he called the light day, the darkness he called night. He divided the light from the darkness. When there's a separation, Genesis 1:3, and God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. There's a separation there. See, when we talk about walking in light, God is doing a comparison. Before you and I got saved, we were in darkness, the darkness of sin. He said, don't walk there anymore. When you get saved, I want you to walk in light. An interesting story in the book of Exodus. I won't have you turn there, but Exodus chapter 10 and verse number 21, it says, and the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand toward heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, even darkness which may be felt. This is one of the plagues where God was going to take the light. He's just going to block out the sun. And in the land of Egypt, God was going to make it so dark you could feel it. You ever been in a place like that? When Ron and I, when we first got married, we were married there in Denver. And we went down to Colorado Springs. And for a boy that grew up in Ohio, I was in shock. When we were in the middle of June, we get up on top of Pikes Peak and it's snowing. That's just not right. But at the bottom of Pikes Peak what are the name of those caverns? The Cave of the Winds down there. It's one of the deepest caverns in America, the deepest caves. And we went down into that. And you go down in there, they wind you down this place, and you're way down in these caverns. And they tell you, grab hold of the hand of the person next to you. So I said, we're going to shut the lights off. And you're going to find out what real darkness is like. And this is back before everybody had their digital watches and the watches that glowed in the dark. We're down in there and Ron and I hold hands and we're holding hands with people next to us and the lights went off. And Brother Mark, you could feel it. There wasn't a speck of light anywhere. And there's no stars. There's no lights in a hallway down there. I mean, everything was dark. I remember wrestling one of my hands free and put it right here in front of my face. I couldn't see my hand. Can you imagine being in that kind of darkness? By the way, that's why hell will be, that kind of darkness. And so here God says to Moses, I'm gonna block out the sun, and in Egypt it's going to be dark, it's going to be darkness you can feel. And it says in verse number 22, and Moses stretched forth his hands toward the heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. And they saw not one another. Neither rose any of them, any from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwelling. God said, I'm going to block it out in Egypt because I'm judging Egypt right now. And I'm going to let my people Israel go. And while they were in darkness, God's people were in light. There was light in Goshen. That's where they were, the land of Goshen. That's the part of Egypt they were in. God said, I want them in darkness, but you, I'm going to let you be in light. That's what happened when you and I got saved. It says there in verse number 8 again, look at it in Ephesians 5. For ye were sometimes darkness. Before you got saved and before I got saved, we were darkness. Amen. That's where we were. In fact, over in the book of Colossians, chapter number 1, so if you want to turn there, if you're in the book of Ephesians, just go to the right a little bit, you come across Philippians, then Colossians. Colossians chapter 1, we begin in verse 9, for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you walk worthy of the Lord and all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long suffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, notice this, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. who delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Before you and I got saved, we were in darkness. When we got saved, God gave the light to us. Hallelujah for that. The Bible says there in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 11, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. When we got saved, we were delivered from the things of darkness. Amen? Now, as a believer, we're supposed to be separate from the works of darkness. What does that mean? There are certain things a believer just should not participate in. In fact, the scriptures just talked about that as we read through there. He talked about that that in verse, let's see if I can find it now, where they talk about some of the things that they did. I'm not going to take the time to go back to it because we have so many of the verses to look at. But there in Ephesians 5, he talks about all the things that before we got saved, we were in darkness, and all those sins that we see listed in verse number 3 and verse number 4, verse number 5. He said, I want you separate from that. You and I will not walk in the light the way God wants us to walk if we keep going back to the darkness. In fact, let's look at 1 John chapter 1. 1 John. So if you get to the book of Revelation, just back up a couple books. You come to 1 John chapter 1. And we'll start in verse number 5. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Here the Bible is telling us we're to walk in the light. That's where we have fellowship with him. Just some thoughts about walking in the light. To walk in the light is to walk with God. God is light, it said there in 1 John, and in him is no darkness at all. You know, one of the problems with hanging around the things of the world is we're hanging around the darkness. You ever notice you go into a place and maybe you walk into a room and the lights are off and you walk in and you don't turn the light on and it takes you a minute to where you can start making out stuff around it. You know what's happening? Your eyes are getting used to the darkness. And I wonder spiritually if that's where we're at. Things that today, a generation ago when I was growing up, things that they would not show in a movie theater, people are watching on Netflix today. They're sitting on their break at work watching a movie, and it's something that the worst people of society would not have gone to a movie theater to see. Brother Mark. We have billboards and advertising that 40 years ago would have been called pornography. And now it's advertising. Well, that's just the culture. Well, the culture's darkness. And as a believer, I'm not supposed to be comfortable in the darkness. What did Jesus tell us? That we're to let our light so shine before men. We had to walk into a room and light the place up. Now that happens when we're walking with God. We're to walk in love, but we're to walk in light. It means we're to walk after him. I love what it says in Isaiah 2 and verse number 5. O house of Jacob, come ye and let us walk in the light of the Lord. You know, if you're going to be with the Lord, you're going to have to be in his book. Every day as you're in the scriptures, God will help you to see what is darkness and what is light. You know, light gives... it gives a lot of perspective to things. Psalm 119, verse 105. Let me turn over there for you. Psalm 119, verse 105. Most of us could probably quote it. The Bible says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The Bible says it's a lamp. And we've used this illustration before. And I meant to bring my, I have one of the little Coleman lanterns. I was going to bring it this morning. That little light, when you turn it on, it just shines the light in an area. Like when the power went out not long ago, and we had to set my lantern right here. It didn't light up everything, but it lit up where I was. Let me see my notes. Amen. Well, that's what the Bible does. It shows me what's around me, and it shows me how to take my next step. If I'm going to walk in light, I've got to be in the Word of God, because that's where the light is. Amen. It shows me how to take my next step. There's other kinds of lights. Brother Hunley has one of these, and he gave me one. I meant to bring it this morning, too. I forgot to grab it out of the garage. One of these little lights you strap on your forehead. You know what I'm talking about? Just a little spotlight. It's like the coal miners used to wear. But you use it when you're working on stuff. The problem is that you're looking at it, and somebody calls your name, and you turn your head, and you've got the new LED one, and you just blinded them. You burn out their retinas. But it shows you what's, you know, how to work. Psalm 119, verse 30, 130 says, "The entrance of thy word giveth light." If you and I are going to learn how to walk with God and to live for God, we've got to walk in the light, and that light is His word. It shows us about Jesus, the light of the world. Psalm 56, 9 through verse number 13 says this, "When I cry unto thee, then shall mine enemies turn back. This I know, for God is for me." Hallelujah for that. In God will I praise His word. In the Lord will I praise His word. In God have I put my trust. I will not be afraid what man can do to me. Thy vows are upon me, O God. I will render praises unto Thee, for Thou hast delivered my soul from death. Wilt Thou not deliver my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of the living? You see, as we walk with God, He gives us the light of how to walk. We are to walk in love. It means we're going to sacrifice for each other. A church is not built unless people sacrifice. People don't get saved unless somebody sacrifices. We're to walk in light. That means that we're going to have to separate from the things of darkness. That's exactly what the Apostle Paul meant when he was writing to the church at Corinth. And he said, "Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath Christ hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part of he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will walk in them, and I will dwell in them and walk in them, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord. And touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty." I'm supposed to be separate from the darkness. As a believer, Brother Mark, people should be able to watch how I live and figure it out with me without me saying a word. They ought to know, don't bother inviting me to your beer party after work, because I'm not coming. Amen. I worked in a print shop for many years, and every Friday night they had a big keg party. Brother Mark, they never invited me. For 5 years I worked there. Not one time did they ever say, "Hey, you want to come?" It might have been when I walked in every day, I set my Bible on my desk and had a pile of tracts there and invited them to stuff at church and witnessed to them. If you've got them inviting you to that stuff over and over again, you might want to take a look at how much light you're shining. They would change how they spoke when they walked into my office. They don't know there's a believer there. Why? Because the light's shining. As a believer, we can't be in the darkness. We can't be acting like them. Jesus was here in the world, but nobody confused Him for being wicked like everybody else. Everybody knew, this man's different. We're to walk in love. We're to walk in light. Look back in the book of Ephesians chapter 5 again. In verse number 15, just give you the last thought. Then we'll go home sometime before 3. Some of you weren't smiling. Look at verse 15, Ephesians 5. "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise." Now that word circumspectly is not a word we use a lot today. It's a good word. It means carefully. Thoughtfully. My favorite illustration of walking circumspectly is, I like to wear loafers. Brother Mark, I've got these and they're really comfortable, but the soles, they're not for walking on ice. You wear these kind of shoes, especially leather-soled loafers, and you walk across an icy parking lot, you're going to hurt yourself. know what I'm talking about? So you get off work and it's snowing and there's ice everywhere, like it could happen next week because we do still live in Michigan. And you go across an icy parking lot. You don't just go busting out the door and run across there. What do? You're walking very carefully. You're placing each foot and you're making sure it's settled before you go forward. Why? Because you don't want to fall down. One of the preachers I know from Texas, they had some snow and ice there in Dallas where he lived. And he said he had a neighbor across the street. It was one of those neighbors we've all had that's always looking out their front windows, wanting to know what you're doing. Always, you know, you'd be working on something. What are you working on? Did you break that? I mean, just one of those kind of neighbors. So he's walking out to go to the church, and it's real icy on his driveway. And he said that as he's walking up next to his pickup, he slipped, hit the ground, and slid under his pickup truck. So the neighbor walked over and said, "You fell, didn't you?" He said, "No, I'm checking out some stuff underneath it." It's in his suit, you know. Said, "I didn't walk circumspectly." The Bible tells here we're to walk circumspectly. We're to be careful in how we live. Titus chapter 3 and verse 8 says, "This is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable unto men." What's he talking about? Walking circumspectly. Do right on purpose. Be careful how you live. Think about what you're doing, how it will affect somebody else. I have a message I'll probably preach next Sunday night on guidelines for debatables. How to make a decision whether you ought to do something or not do something if you can't find a verse that specifically says do this or not. There's a lot of stuff in our Christian life. The Bible doesn't talk about that thing. So what are you talking about? Well, like smoking. God, there's not a verse in the Bible that says, "Thou shalt not smoke cigarettes." Well, it's getting real quiet. Where's he going with that? But there are tons of verses telling me that this is the temple of God. I'm not supposed to defile it. Talk about my physical body. Hello. That's God's temple I'm setting on fire. And that can apply to stuff we eat, other activities we do. All right? So there's some principles. I'm supposed to be careful how I live. In Daniel chapter 1 verse 8, it says, "But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor the wine which he drank. Thereof he requested the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself." He was a prisoner of war. He was in a foreign government. And he determined, Brother Mark, "I'm not going to live the way they do." It was a decision. What is that? That's walking circumspectly. It says about David in 1 Samuel 18:28-30, "And Saul saw and knew that the Lord was with David, and that Michal, Saul's daughter, loved him. And Saul was yet more afraid of David, and Saul became David's enemy continually. And then the princes of the Philistines went forth, and it came to pass after they went forth that David behaved himself more wisely than all the servants of Saul, so that his name was much set by." That tells me that David, He was very careful in how he behaved himself. He knew Saul was against him. But David was never against Saul. He was the most loyal soldier King Saul ever had. And he was very careful when he did something that it didn't look like he was against the king. So not only should we live right, but we should live right in such a way that people know we're living right. The Bible says, "Let not your good be evil spoken of." Do right in a way people can't criticize it. Just live right in such a way that if they did criticize the people, say, "No, you don't know what you're talking about." It says in Proverbs 4:26, "Ponder the path of thy feet, let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right hand or to the left, remove thy foot from evil." We're to set out on purpose to walk with God and to walk circumspectly. Be careful as well. This week, think about what you're doing. Think about where you go, what the appearances are. I'll give you this last illustration. Dad's mom, my grandma, she was one of those that wanted to make sure everybody knew she was a child of God. She didn't want anything in her life to remind you of the world. Now, back when we used to go to her house, this would have been back in the late 60s, early 70s, as a kid, soft drinks, pop, as we call it, They call it soda. Just it's like fingernails on a chalkboard when you say that. It's pop. You go to South Carolina, it's Coke. It doesn't matter if it's Dr. Pepper, it's Coke. You want a Coke? You know. But anyway, those first came out in cans. I remember Coca-Cola used to come in the bottles. It had the special shape. You couldn't read and you still know that's a bottle of Coca-Cola because of the shape. And Pepsi had their shape. You know what I'm talking about? And Sprite had theirs. We brought in one time over to her house, we brought in some cans of pop, as we call it. My grandmother threw a fit. She said, Carl, that's my dad. What are you bringing that in my house? Get that out of my house. She said, Dad, or Mom, it's Cokes. It's pop. Looks like a beer can. Well, pop cans were just coming out. They were in bottles before that. And in grandma's mind, that looked like a beer can. Get that out of my house. That's how careful grandma was. She didn't want anybody to come by her house. Oh, they were in there drinking beer in your living room, huh? When was the last time you were that careful about your Christian life? Were to walk circumspectly. Why? Because the devil's going to try to trip you up. I'm walking down here a lot this morning because when I was first preaching this morning, we've got a wire that comes out of the pulpit with the microphone wire, and it's taped to the floor. Well, I ripped it loose this morning the first time I stepped by the pulpit, and I've tripped on it twice. So I'm standing down here, Brother Mark, so I don't fall down and fall off the platform. Because some of you would video that and put it on YouTube. So I'm standing down here where it's safe. As a believer, you must plan to do right. And first, in Haggai 1, verse 5, it says, Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little, ye eat, but ye have not enough. You drink, but ye are not filled with drink. Ye clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put him into a bag with holes. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. What's God saying? You gotta think about how you're walking. So the question this morning is this: how's your walk? Are you walking in light? Have you even come to the light? Have you ever trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? If you've never accepted him, today would be the day to do that. Come into the light. Come, let him wash away your sins and give you the light that only he can give. But as a believer, let's not continue in darkness. Let's walk in the light of the Lord. But not only that, let's walk in love. Let's be careful how we treat each other. You know, Jesus was never mean and hurtful to people. Now, there were times he had to be stern because they were violating the Word of God. But the Bible says about Jesus, he was a friend of sinners. Everybody knew this man loved them. When Lazarus died in John chapter 11, and Jesus came, and the Bible says Jesus wept, the Jews that hated him said this, oh, how he loved him. They knew Jesus cared for that man. I wonder, do people know we love them? Let's walk in love this week. Let's sacrificially do that. Let's walk in the light. Let's be separate. Then let's walk circumspectly. Let's be careful in our Christian life. How's your walk? Let's pray. Father, thank you for the scriptures this morning. Thank you for these very, very clear instructions for us as believers. May we understand how important it is that we're careful with our walk. May this morning we examine our lives and may we ask ourselves, are we walking in the light? Are we walking in love? Are we walking circumspectly? Before I finish my prayer with heads bowed, eyes closed, please, nobody looking around. Who would say this morning, Pastor, I've already been saved. I've trusted Jesus as my Savior. I know I'm going to heaven. Here's my hands of testimony. You raise your hands and that's me. Well, that's a wonderful thing. You put your hands down. Now with heads bowed and eyes closed, nobody looking around, please. Say, Pastor, I do not know for sure that I'm going to go to heaven, but I'd like to know that. Pastor, pray for me. I'm not sure I'm saved. Pray for me. Would you lift your hand anybody like that today? Thank you. All right. In a moment, we'll have what we call an invitation. We'll stand. Brother John will sing. If God spoke to you about that, you'd like to know how to be saved, just slip out of your seat and come to the front. We'll have somebody take the Bible and show you that. Who'd say this morning, Pastor, but honestly, as I examine my life, I'm not walking in love like I ought to be. I'm not demonstrating God's love. I've been sacrificial towards others. And Pastor, God spoke to me about that. Pray for me. Would you lift your hands and say, that's me today. Walking in love is not something that I've been doing much lately. Thank you.
who would say this morning, Pastor, when it comes to this matter of walking in the light and being separate from the darkness, Pastor, I'm struggling in that area. Pastor, pray for me. Would you lift your hands? That's me. Thank you. You can put those hands down. Then lastly, he would say, Pastor, to be real honest, I've not been walking circumspectly or carefully. My Christian life's been kind of casual, and I've not been on purpose doing things that I'm supposed to do. And God spoke to me about that. Pastor, pray for me. That's me today. Would you lift your hands? That's me. Thank you. Let's all stand together while I finish my prayer. Father, you know our hearts. You've seen the hands. You know what our needs are. I pray each of us in this room this morning would respond to your truth. Pray if there's one that does not know Jesus as Savior, there's one or two that did raise their hands. I pray you'd help them to have the faith to step out and allow us to take the Bible and show them clearly what it means to be a child of God. Help the remainder of us that are saved to then look at our walk. Examine those areas we talked about this morning, and may you help us to respond to you in the way you convicted us and spoke to us. May we come to this altar and make some decisions that this week our walk will be different. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As heads are bowed and eyes are closed, Brother John's going to sing. If God spoke to you, would you slip out of your seat and come to the altar?
All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him. In His presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Thank you. I should look this way. Thanks for being in church this morning. And I invite you back tonight, 6 o'clock. And, of course, Wednesday night's our Bible study. And then next Sunday will be our carrying dinner. And we just, whatever you want to eat, you bring. Amen. We'll put it all there together, and we'll just share. Amen. So bring enough for you and your family, and bring some for extra. Amen. And I'm putting out a request right now. No baked cookies. Some of you know how to make those. I have a deficiency. I had my blood tested this week. I'm low on those. And so... Becky, did you hear that? Okay, just checking, because she keeps teasing me. I got the stuff. I don't have any cookies. But anyway, Brother John, you come and pray for us.
All right, if you have children over in the nurseries, be sure to pick them up, and then the bookstore will be open if you need anything. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the message this morning. Thank you for the examples in the scriptures that you give us on how we are to walk. I pray you'll help us to take the message this morning and take the thoughts that are presented to us from the scriptures and find a way that we can apply it to our lives this week, even starting today, that we might have a better relationship with you, that we might have a better judgment seat. I pray you'll just take us out safely this afternoon and bring us back safely this evening at church tonight at 6 o'clock. We thank you in advance for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You are dismissed.